în orașul natal. Eu sunt născut la 100 de metri de aici, pe strada universității. I would have to give the talk in English, unfortunately, because my parents left Galati when I was 14. So my professional language is not good enough to be able to give the talk in Romanian. If I would try to do it, you'll probably have to stay here until lunch. From time to time I'll have to look back to see my slides. I'm not used to talk about slides. Even to my wife, I talk with slides. I talk to myself with slides. Everybody turns around and say the name of schizophrenia is a misnomer. It shouldn't be called schizophrenia. We should make up a new name. By the way, in Japan and in Korea, they already have a new name for schizophrenia. Don't know it in Japanese or Korean, but they have a new name. The question is, how come, despite the fact that it is a misnomer, how come it survived for so long? Well, it fits the agenda of many stakeholders. It fits the agenda of physicians like ourselves. We like to diagnose diseases. We like to have dichotomous diagnosis, yes, no. So with all the shortcomings, it fits the agenda. The question is, would it make a difference with this person do any better if we change the name? And I'm afraid with all the shortcomings, this will not make a difference. In general, if you think that marketing and naming would make a difference, this is probably not true. And I give you here several examples where if you use better names, in the end, it's not going to make a big difference. So let's leave the branding to people who do branding, and let's focus our energies and our efforts in trying to to research the biology and the etiology of schizophrenia. Now, this is just to give you an example of the controversy that goes around in the literature about the name of schizophrenia. Does it exist? Does it not exist? I highly recommend to you, there is a new article by Jim Vanos, The Slow Death of Schizophrenia. If you send me mail at the end, by the way, you can have the slides, you don't have to take pictures, you can have the slides, it's okay. I'll leave them here, or send me mail, and I'll send you all the slides. It's okay if you want to take pictures, don't bother. You can take pictures of me. So, the issue of the naming, it's a major issue in the literature, and it does have some significance. Now, when you think about, I'm done with the naming. For the rest of it, I want to talk a little bit about drug development in schizophrenia. I spent most of my professional life in academia, and for the last 3-4 years, I switched to drug development. Very interesting, a new career. So what are the hurdles, what are the problems of drug development in general in mental illness, and in particular in schizophrenia? We have no basic understanding of the pathophysiology of mental illness. In the end, we know very little, if anything, of the pathophysiology of mental illness. We don't have good experimental models for mental illness. We have some experimental models for depression, helplessness, we have some experimental models for anxiety, we have no experimental model whatsoever for schizophrenia. What is called experimental model for schizophrenia are basically experimental models for adverse effects of drugs which ameliorate schizophrenia. They are not experimental models for schizophrenia. We are looking for the last 50 years or 100 years, we are looking for the gene for schizophrenia. I'll come back to it in a moment. But this is silly. We will never find a gene for schizophrenia because like ischemic heart disease, like diabetes, like all the common diseases, it's a multifactorial polygenetic disease. It's not a single gene disease. And different combinations of genes probably make up schizophrenia. Again, I'll show you data in a moment. So the idea, you see from time to time in newspaper, in the lay press, gene for schizophrenia was found, or the gene for Alzheimer's was found. This is silly. You cannot find a gene for a common disease. If schizophrenia was caused by a gene, or by two genes, or by three genes, it would have disappeared long ago, because as you know very well, schizophrenic people tend to marry less than the general population, tend to have children less than the general population, so it would have, evolution would have taken it away long ago if it was a single gene disease. We have no, again, and it's true not only about schizophrenia, it's true about mental illness in general, we have no objective markers for diagnosis. All our markers and outcomes are clinical and subjective. No objective markers whatsoever. Again, people like myself and tens and hundreds of thousands of other researchers are eagerly researching to find a biological marker for depression, schizophrenia, whatever. For the moment, we have no biological marker whatsoever. And again, I invite you to challenge me, imaging, catecholamines, anything you want. I will be happy to debate why they are not biological markers. Now, despite this apparently pessimistic view, there are a lot of reasons and a lot of drivers why, in the end, we will develop drugs for mental illness and for schizophrenia in particular. Those are very common conditions. By the way, any idea, any guess, in the general population, lifelong, what is the prevalence of mental illness? Meaning, what is the chance of anybody in this room to suffer any time during the life from an episode of mental illness? Any idea?
75%.
50%, whatever. 50%, depends, you know, like epidemiology, you'll find different quotations, anywhere between 40 to 75%. So those are very common conditions, therefore, governments, pharmaceutical industry, academia will continue to put in efforts in finding, despite all the hurdles that I pointed out. It is a major burden to the system, as I already pointed out. Tenacity, educated serendipity, and slow incremental in scientific research will in the end pay off. Fact, we do have drugs for mental illnesses. There are all came out of serendipity. By the way, any idea what is the difference between chance and serendipity? Chance, if I go out and find $100 bill, this is by chance. This is not by serendipity because I was not looking for $100 bill. So serendipity has to be helped by science. People who found antipsychotics, antidepressants by serendipity were scientists, were not people looking for $100 bill. More important, I have probably done in my career probably 100 if not more, drug trials to find a better drug for schizophrenia. All of them were negative. But one success, one single success, will make up for all the failures in terms of economics, in terms of narcissism, in terms of everything. So despite a lot of failures, one success will make up for all the failures. Now, where did we start? This is where the treatment of schizophrenia started, called DAS, holes in the brain. By the way, the reason I'm putting this slide, I want to, you know, this guy, Moniz, got the Nobel Prize for lobectomy. What he was doing was lobectomy for schizophrenia, and he got the Nobel Prize for lobectomy. Now, it sounds to all of you ridiculous, right? Always remember, the cutting edge science of today will be ridiculous 5 years from now. Everything that we believe is cutting edge science will be ridiculous a few years from now. I can give you any example from, I see only young people here, really. But you probably still remember it. If somebody would have told you 20 years ago that duodenal ulcer is an infectious disease, you would say, you are out of your mind. Duodenal ulcer cannot be an infectious disease. Now, most of you probably don't even know that there is anything else but an infectious disease. I can go on and give you examples. So keep in mind, he was doing cutting edge science when he got the Nobel Prize, which seems to us ridiculous, human, anything you want. I'm going back to drug development. So what are the limitations of the current drugs that we use in psychiatry? Well, for most of them, the improvement is only partial. The effects are relatively small. I told you I'm now into drug development. And whoever works in psychiatry in Galati should know, we are using your city as a center for a drug that we are developing for negative symptoms of schizophrenia. I'll present in a second. But the point I'm trying to make is that the effect sizes are so small in general in psychiatry that you may have true phase two results, positive results, and then when you move to do a larger study in phase three, the positive results disappear. And the reason they disappear is not because the results in phase two are not true, but because the effect size is so small, when you introduce a little bit of noise, the effect disappears. Most of our drugs have slow onset of action. Antidepressants, you have to wait a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Meanwhile, the patient commits suicide. By the way, are you all familiar with a new drug being developed, ketamine, against suicide? One of the reasons ketamine is being developed, if it's going to work, and I wouldn't put my pension plan on ketamine, but if it is going to work, the reason it's being developed is because it has a very fast onset of action. Poor tolerability. Most people, whoever practices here psychiatry knows, all you hear from your patients is adverse effects, adverse effects, adverse effects. Frequent symptoms recurrence. Somebody gets better, symptoms disappear, and 3 months down the road, symptoms come back again. So here are the limitations of the current drugs. Now, a little bit about schizophrenia and treatment of schizophrenia. Remember, the drugs for schizophrenia were initially found by serendipity. You know, two anesthesiologists who noticed that they put to sleep for anesthesia a patient with schizophrenia. When he woke up from anesthesia, he was better. They tested it. That was chloropromazine. They tested chloropromazine. By the way, why most of the drugs that came after chloropromazine are not better than chloropromazine in terms of efficacy? Do you know? Any idea? How come chloropromazine was found in the 50s? Everything that came afterwards is more or less the same in terms of efficacy. Because the way all those drugs were developed, people took chloropromazine, took a different drug which was similar to chloropromazine, proved that in vitro and in laboratory animal, it does the same as chloropromazine. Then they moved it into clinical trial. If it was successful, it was successful. But then all you do is most of the same. Did you know the term me-too drugs? This is how you develop me-too drugs. You take a drug that works, you show that another drug does the same in vitro and in laboratory animals, you bring it to clinic, and all you develop is, again, the same drug. Now, what has happened in the 70s, people figure out that chloropromazine and haloperidol and all the drugs that were given to schizophrenia, they figure out in the 70s that they block dopamine 2 receptors. Now, again, if all you do, you develop drugs that block dopamine 2 receptors, you'll end up finding the same drug. Furthermore, the dopamine hypothesis was adopted and accepted by all of us because it made a lot of sense. We physicians are in love with mechanisms, with understanding pathophysiology, and the moment we got a hint, we adopted it. Now, is anybody aware in this room of any dopamine abnormality in schizophrenia? I spent about 15 years of my career trying to demonstrate dopamine abnormalities in schizophrenia. Nothing. We don't know of any. Although all effective drugs in psychosis block dopamine receptors, we have not been able to demonstrate any dopamine abnormality in schizophrenia. What are the solutions? We don't know, we don't understand. What are the solutions? One proposed solution is to decompose schizophrenia in symptoms and try to go after specific symptoms. Cognition, negative symptoms, specific items on cognition, and try to focus just on the specific items. Now, this is pretty obvious. How come we don't do it? Any idea? How come? It's obvious that schizophrenia is not really a biological disease, that it encompasses a lot of biological, social issue. You cannot treat it with a drug. You have to decompose it in specific symptoms and try to develop symptoms for this specific, and try to develop drug for these specific symptoms. How come it was not done? I mean, it's not, you don't have to be a genius to figure it out. It is not done because regulators, FDA, European EMEA, regulators approve drugs for diseases. So if something appears in DSM as a disease, the FDA or other regulators turn around and say, fine, I will approve for marketing a drug for this particular disease, not for symptoms. So although it makes a lot of sense, because of bureaucratic reasons, it's not being done. I talked to you before a little bit about schizophrenia and genetics. And look, all those lines are so-called genes, which when you do genetic analysis in people with schizophrenia, this was published in Nature. So when you do genetic analysis in groups of people with schizophrenia, in the group of in the normal people, here is what you find in terms of mutations. So all those are mutations that distinguish between groups of schizophrenics and normal controls. Now, if this is not helpful, because once you find a mutation, you want to know what is the biological meaning of this mutation. So you have to find out, is this mutated gene making a different enzyme? Is it not making the enzyme? What is the biological meaning? Now, go and figure out what is the biological meaning of all those mutations. This is not possible. So now another problem. You never have, you can never get a completely homogeneous, not even phenomenological homogeneous, forget about biological homogeneous, you cannot find a phenomenological homogeneous group of individuals in your cohort. Do you really know to make the difference between early onset schizophrenia and slight mental retardation? Or make the difference between mildly severe autism and schizophrenia? Or bipolar disorder and schizoaffective disorder? There's no way you can do it even on a phenomenological level. How do you now move from it to find an allele for risk and to find the functionality of this allele? Back to antipsychotic drugs. What do antipsychotic drugs in the end do? What is it they don't do, but we behave as if they do? In the end, antipsychotic drugs are anti-agitation drugs. Again, for people who work with patients suffering from schizophrenia, how many times it happened to you, the two things that happened? Somebody is floridly psychotic. Is God, is the son of God, is walking on water, anything you want. You give them antipsychotics, so-called, they are less agitated and less bothered by the delusions and the hallucination. You turn around and you ask them, Mr. So-and-so, do you still believe that whatever? And what they really tell you, they don't tell you, I don't believe, I'm convinced, I'm not God. They tell you, leave it alone, it doesn't bother me. So it's the intensity that goes away, the intensity, the emotional intensity, but it's not the hallucination itself that goes away. The point I'm trying to make is that in the end, again, for older people in the room, antipsychotic drugs were called major tranquilizers when they first came on the market. They are major tranquilizers. This is what they do. They don't really treat psychosis. Second generation, first generation drugs. I see outside a lot of pharma people, so I'm going to be careful. We are all, including myself, very enthusiastic in the early 90s when second generation antipsychotics came on the market. The reason was we were looking for something new. We are unhappy with what we have. But most of the second generation drugs were, again, as I explained to you, people took compounds from the shelf, from the pharmaceutical shelf, showed that in vitro and in animals they do what haloperidol was doing, and then brought them to the clinic. So what they really got is more of the same. What I'm showing you here is that most of the second generation antipsychotics in terms of efficacy, are not very different than first generation antipsychotics. They may have a little bit less adverse effects, but mostly they have different adverse effects. I'm not sure that they are even different. Here are two big studies conducted to show if there is a difference or not between first and second generation, independently funded. One was funded by the United States government, the Katy. The other one was funded by a consortium European Community Investigators was UFEST. It was published in Lancet. This one was published in New England. And what they basically showed said that if there are any differences between first and second generation drugs, the differences are very small. This is a big meta-analysis conducted by Stefan Loich, again, showing that after 60 years of antipsychotic drugs, we still don't know how they function and still have relatively small effect size. This is maintenance, percentage of people who relapse on maintenance, and as you can see, the differences are not very impressive. I'm not going to talk about it for a second. Oh, again, I don't want to leave you with a pessimistic view of what we do. And I'm trying to make the point here that in terms of antipsychotics and schizophrenia and congestive heart failure, we all take for granted that we have good drugs to treat congestive heart failure. If you take them one by one, what can antipsychotic do? And what drugs for congestive heart failure do? One by one, they do the same in terms of effect size, in terms of treating a chronic disease. I started my career as a cardiologist, by the way. I then switched to psychiatry. So this is why I use examples from cardiology. In cardiology, which had a lot of breakthrough in the last 25 years, we are not doing any better than in psychiatry. So when we deal with chronic illnesses, by definitions, we are not very good at treating chronic illnesses. He is to make the point that despite 60 years of antipsychotic treatment, functionally, people with schizophrenia do the same as they were doing before antipsychotics were available. We did a study, I moved between Israel and the United States. I do some of the studies in Israel, some of the studies in Tel Aviv, some of the studies I do in New York. This is a study done in Tel Aviv. What we did, we linked the database in Israel, a registry with all the people with a diagnosis of schizophrenia. We took this registry and we linked it with the tax office, where you have the income of every citizen. So we try to understand how many people with a diagnosis of schizophrenia make minimal wages. Minimal wages, about 10%. So to make the point that despite the best effort, no more than 10% of people with schizophrenia make minimal wages. And we review the literature. This is not a local specific issue. This is true everywhere. I don't think that in your country things are any better from this point of view. I convinced you that schizophrenia is not a biological disease with a single cause, but it is a disease with probably many biological abnormalities. But we still behave as if there is a single biological abnormality and we try to treat it. The guidelines, if you look at the guidelines, treatment guidelines, all you see is use antipsychotics, use it for 2-3 years in the first episode, and use it forever if there are recurrences. The question is, I'm trying to challenge those guidelines, and again, I invite you, if enough time is left when I'm done, to tell me what is your opinion, but I really am not convinced that the guidelines are correct. One thing we tend to do when a patient is not better, we start with one drug. What we tend to do is to switch to a different drug. Now, is it helpful? A very large study funded by the European community called Optimize, if you research on Medline. I think it's already published or it's in the review in Lancet, Optimize, did the simple following thing. Took first episode patients, put them on amisulpiride. Why amisulpiride? Because it's a little bit more effective than the rest. Open label, whoever went into remission on amisulpiride led the study. Whoever did not remit it was randomized to olanzapine and amisulpiride, blindly now, for the next 6 weeks. When we opened the database, what we found out, there was no difference between people continuing on amisulpiride or people switch to olanzapine. The point I'm trying to make is that switching between similar drugs is probably not helpful. I know we all do it, I do it too, but the data shows it doesn't make a difference. This is just the data itself. You cannot see it, sorry. But believe me, it doesn't make a difference. I want to talk a little bit about negative symptoms. Now, I have to warn you. How much more time do I have? Okay. I want to talk a little bit about schizophrenia and negative symptoms. I have to warn you. I'm the chief medical officer of a company which is now developing a drug for negative symptoms, and you here in Galatz are a site for this development. But just to warn you, conflict of interest, whatever I say, I'm an employee of the company that develops this drug. A little bit about negative symptoms in schizophrenia. I'm sure you are all familiar with them. We have primary negative symptoms, which are part of the disease. Generally, negative symptoms appear even before the first psychotic episode. I know there are child psychiatrists in the audience. You probably, child psychiatrists, see it more than anybody else. You see this 15, 16-year-old kid, which what he mainly has is negative symptoms. He sits in his room, doesn't have any friends. He's not psychotic yet. He will be psychotic 2 years from the first time you see him. Then negative symptoms stay with you even when psychotic symptoms go away. So this, in my mind at least, primary negative symptoms are really what schizophrenia is all about. We all associate schizophrenia with psychosis, with being crazy. Because we remember and we are fascinated by out of the ordinary, and psychosis is out of the ordinary, negative symptoms are not out of the ordinary. We have data, we did an epidemiological study, if you do a search with my name, we did about many years ago, an epidemiological study going from door to door. I'm doing an epidemiological study, how are you, do you hear voices? If they don't shoot you, and if they are willing to be interviewed, what we found out is that you find negative symptoms in the general population. So the psychosis is only a small part of schizophrenia. What schizophrenia is probably all about is negative symptoms. By the way, negative symptoms are not only features of schizophrenia. There are two phenomena that manifest in every mental illness: cognitive impairment and negative symptoms. If something goes wrong with the brain, the first thing you see is a little bit of post-traumatic brain disorder, Parkinson's disease, beginning of Alzheimer's disease, autism, post-depression apathy, and I can go on and on and on. What you see is negative symptoms and cognitive impairment. Those are the most common manifestation that something is wrong with your brain. On top of it, in schizophrenia, you have secondary negative symptoms. What are secondary negative symptoms? Secondary negative symptoms are the symptoms produced by antipsychotics. How many times you see you give a patient an antipsychotic, psychosis goes away, but the patient is negative symptoms. So in a way, you treat a little bit the negative symptoms of antipsychotics, because if you are preoccupied with voices and you are afraid that the CIA is after you, you don't interact and you look as if you have negative symptoms. But then on the other hand, you produce negative symptoms with the drug that you are trying to treat. So most of the antipsychotics do produce negative symptoms. I'm just trying to make the point that antipsychotics do improve a little bit negative symptoms on one hand, or apathy. On the other hand, they make apathy and negative symptoms worse. This is just to make the point that secondary negative symptoms are a major issue for our patients. How many times in your practice the patient has discontinued on his own antipsychotics, and for a while he's a little bit better, for a while, because he's not suffering the secondary negative symptoms. Now, a lot of attempts have been made to treat negative symptoms, and here are all the attempts, and there are probably more than what I listed here, attempts to treat negative symptoms. All of them, remember at the beginning of my talk, I told you I probably did 100 trials, all of them negative. Here they are. This is a drug that we are developing now. The data, the phase 2B data was published in the American Journal of Psychiatry. Since I'm the first author, I'm recommending it that you read it. It was published in December last year. This is this new drug, which is trying to treat negative symptoms. It is a 5-HT2 sigma-2 blocker. It has no effect, it has no affinity for D2 receptors. So it is completely different from the current antipsychotics. No affinities whatsoever for dopamine blockers, which may be a problem in the end, but for the moment, it is definitely a novel drug. It is not going to be a new drug. Here is the data itself, the data that we published in the American Journal. We took schizophrenic patients with a score, with a particular cutoff score, meaning with relatively moderate to severe negative symptoms. And here is the data itself. We showed that both doses of this experimental drug, that again, you will be part of phase 3 trial, both doses were better than placebo in ameliorating negative symptoms. This is just the items themselves to show you that it particularly goes, the drug goes after apathy. People, schizophrenic people, apathetic at all of a sudden wake up, are a little bit interested to read the newspaper, to interact, and it has nothing to do, it's not a Ritalin amphetamine-like drug. This is to make the point that younger people benefit from this drug more than older people. There is an age effect, which went against my hypothesis. When I started the study, I was sure that older people would do better because they have worse negative symptoms. I was wrong as usual. Younger people do better with this drug. This is just a continuation of the open label part of it. Here are all the companies which are now at work trying to develop more drugs for schizophrenia. What do we do next? Well, again, if I knew what to do next, I wouldn't be here, I would be in the lab doing it. Should we probably leave it to younger and smarter people to do it? There are a lot of options of what we should do next. This is what I'm doing for the moment. And here is my email if you want the slides or anything else related to it. Thank you very much. You wouldn't be surprised that the malnutrition, any event during the fetal period constitutes a risk factor for schizophrenia, but only a risk factor, a very small risk factor. So yes, there are risk factors related to the fetal period, but the level of risk that it adds is very, very small. in the afternoon, I'll give a talk about suicide, but I'm going to talk more about how to assess risk. And I'll try to make the point that we get confused between risk and certainty, and I'll elaborate on it. So yes, events during the fetal period are risk factors, but very small for the moment.
Okay.
Yes. I said a lot of unusual things. Nobody wants to challenge it? Go ahead.
I was wondering if what were the effects of those agents towards positive psychotic symptoms. Are there any
which effects?
The agents for the negative symptoms.
Okay.
And I have three questions. That's the first. The other one is, have you experimented those agents together with typical agents? And the last question is that is the effect on the cerebral system similar to the typical agents, the antipsychotic agents, because they also have.
Repeat the first one. Was the first?
The first one was what was the effect over the positive psychotic symptoms?
Okay. So the first, remember that the design of the trial was not adding this new drug to an antipsychotic, but was monotherapy. It was not added to a drug. I'll give you the good reason and the real reason. You know, any psychoanalyst here in the room? You know, for psychoanalysts, everything, there is a good reason, which is very good. It's not the real reason, but the good reason is good enough. So I'll give you the good reason and the real reason. The good reason why we did monotherapy and not add on to an antipsychotic was because, as I told you, antipsychotics by themselves cause secondary negative symptoms. So we are afraid that the effect size of our new drug is not large enough to treat the primary negative symptoms of schizophrenia and the secondary negative symptoms caused by the D2 blockers. We are afraid that since once you block dopamine receptors, right, all the reward system is dopamine circuit related. Dopamine mediates the reward system. Once you block it, you probably cannot treat negative symptoms, because if you cannot expect reward, you cannot treat negative symptoms. So that was a good reason, which is good enough. The real reason was, very rarely, the drug itself causes QT interval prolongation. Most of the antipsychotics cause QT prolongations. So we are concerned for the moment, until we learn more about the drug, we didn't want to give two drugs, both of which may cause QT prolongation. Turns out it doesn't, but now it's a different issue.
The other question was, what was the effect of these agents towards the positive symptoms?
Oh, okay.
Did it have any effect? Because we need probably to treat the positive symptoms.
First of all, I told you it is also sigma 2 blocker and 5-HT2 blockers. All the antipsychotics are 5-HT2
yes.
blockers. So, I it was towards the end of my presentation, so I went fast. But we went on open label and gave it beyond 12 weeks. We gave it for additional 6 months. During the 6 months, there were very few exacerbations. So probably, I'm not sure the drug can ameliorate positive symptoms in acutely psychotic patients, but it helps maintain remission.
So it's likely to win bipolar.
Okay, it's a good example.
Okay. So for maintenance, but not for treatment.
Correct.
Okay.
My hunch, my expectation, that if this drug will ever be on the market, people will use the regular D2 blocker for the acute episode. Once the acute episode is gone, they will probably switch to this drug
yes.
Which improves negative symptoms and probably helps maintain remission. That's just
my experience. It's very like lithium, yes. Because
could be. Any other questions? Puteți să întrebați în românești de ei, pe bun.
Am o curiozitate. Dacă au fost inventate măsurile astea care să afecteze simptomele negative, nu există și alternative, cum ar fi terapii hormonale, sau niște studii cu oxitocinare, unde au ceva influențe?
Again, for the moment, there is no drug whatever that improves negative symptoms. Nothing. Or, by the way, a very large study was done with there is some plausibility that estrogen may help negative symptoms. There is a finding that estrogen improves negative symptoms too. Now the investigators that has done it, it was Professor Weiser, is now trying to replicate his own finding. But for the moment there is no drug that fits in. This is the bottom line. Yes. Eu nu sunt de bine că nu s-a tradus.
Este o problemă. V-am scos din joc. V-am spus de la început, exact. Nu-i direct cancer, este mai puțin decât schizofrenia, se pun în semn de egalitate. Am înțeles, el era o doamnă doctor, psihiatra, coordonatoarea noastră, de la copii, care spunea în toată lumea, este o problemă, acest autism nu este foarte clar. Dacă este schizofrenie sau nu. Și câtă parte este? Este jumătate din schizofrenie? E trei sferturi? E un deget sau e zero?
Probabil amândouă sunt developmental diseases. Genetic este o mulțime de comunalitate între ele. Fenomenologic este comunalitate. Early onset schizofrenia și autism. Care e diferența? Nu știu. Probabil este mult comunalitate precis fenomenologică.
Autismul are mai multe lucruri decât această dizarmonie.
I wish
deci
I knew.
E vorba de ADHD, e vorba de... Deci s-a făcut o diferențiere între ele. Deci nu puteți spune exact. Asta spunea și doamna doctor Palabrier, că în afară nu se stăpânește problema.